Mark, can you explain to me about the primal current? Because there's a lot behind that, and really, you know, I've tried to connect the dots, and I've tried to simulate an answer myself. I understand, but I'm not as good as articulating it as good as you are.
Do you mean the current or the primal craft?
The primal craft.
The primal craft itself, okay. Well, as I explained before, the primal craft being the practice of the Atlantean faith, of the Atlantean priesthood, the followers of the goddess, the supreme dark magical power, the supreme dark goddess that identified herself within this current when bringing this Gnosis back as Hecate. Okay? Some people will know her as the first dragon of the void, as I've already explained. So the primal craft is that practice, but do you mean as to why I have called everything that I do the primal craft, and you want me to identify the different vehicles for transmitting the current?
I would say so, because you know, from what I can gather, there's a lot to be drawn, a lot to be gathered from the primal craft. You know, just overall, and the current there is no. I wouldn't say there is no other way, but this is the main way, and this is the source. And I'd like for you to explain this path.
Okay. Well, the primal craft itself is the practice. Hence, all of the work that I put forward comes under the, it's covered by the heading the primal craft. That will be the name of the practice itself. Within what I do and the knowledge that I put forward, there are more than one, there are several vehicles through which that current is transmitted. Initially, it was the work that I do, that I'm still doing, that is the primal craft, that is the practice, the soul transmutation, all of the knowledge, all of the power, right from evocation and manifestation through to malefica, through to the various different rituals and gateways through which the soul can walk in spiritual evolution and transmutation, okay? Evolving itself and advancing, as we've already covered. That was the work that I initially began. When Hecate wanted me to start putting forward the written work, I initially published with some other publishers, and then I think was always her goal was to open Primal Craft as a publishing house, as a vehicle solely for the publication and the transmission in the written word of the Primal Craft current. Therefore, Primal Craft occult publishing within the foundation of Primal Craft itself is the vehicle that I use to put forward the written works, the books through which the current is transmitted. Primal Craft itself, as in, if you're looking at, I have the website Primal Craft, through which I host the written works, and I put forward knowledge to subscribers or just on the website itself, informing people of different projects that have been undertaken by different initiates, such as the Garden of the Fountain of the Gods. It's a long-term project in rural England that's been ignited as a gateway to Hecate and the gods of the Trident of Witch Flame, and the Four Pillars of Fire, which are connected to the Mother Temple that I'll come back to in a minute. This all comes under Primal Craft. So when I opened Primal Craft, I opened it, it's expanded as the foundation for the primal witchcraft of Hecate, for the first faith of freedom, for the practices and praxis of the Trident of Witch Flame, the gods, the spirits, the beings that are encompassed within that, that come forth as teachers to the initiate, to the student, and still to myself. So that I would call that the Primal Craft Foundation, or Primal Craft as the foundation for the transmission of this knowledge. Again, within that, Primal Craft Occult Publishing is the vehicle for putting forward the written works. And several years ago, I was led to the Spanish mountains to a particular location to rediscover what is essentially a stone vortex that required months and months and months of work and restoration to put the stones back in the circular vortex, and the reconstruction of the Four Pillars of Fire, etc. This is the Mother Temple, and it began a few years ago now with Hecate actually transmitting knowledge to me. You will open a temple for me. And I think I covered in a previous interview, I wasn't thinking about it laterally. I was kind of thinking, okay, well, yeah, absolutely, I'll do that. But, you know, I was thinking temple and archways and adorned with gold, and I'm going to have to do some serious financial manifestation for that. It's not the sort of temple she was talking about. She was talking about a primal temple. A temple is a circular vortex people that are more historically in tune than myself will perhaps identify with the fact that some of the first sacrificial temples were actually circles of stone that are sunken into the ground, which is essentially the basis for this temple, although there's quite a bit more structure to it than that now, because I've put the structure to it and I've been directed to do it over a period of years. That's the mother temple. The formula for that, once I was directed to this place in intuition and in working with possession and working on the mundane, reconstructing the temple, the formula for opening it is the formula of the backward way of Akate. Basically, in short, open the temple as a vortex back to the Atlantean inner planes. And it's the primary vortex for the Atlantean current within this particular aeon at this time. And the temple will stand long after I'm gone. There is a proposed, anyone who's reading the Altar of Sacrifice will have seen a brief coverage of the temple apprentice. In later works, as I've released all of the knowledge to for people to recreate or replicate these temples and these gateways, and if they wish, link them to the Mother Temple, or to keep them separate as their own coven circles, orders, gateways to the source of power, the Atlantean inner planes, which in turn are connected to the source itself, the supreme dark goddess Hecate, then that's one of the purposes and some of the knowledge that's within the Altar of Sacrifice, the first book of the volumes of the Way of Sacrifice, which is effectively the beginning of what appears to be a second trilogy. Then I've put that knowledge forward regarding the Mother Temple itself, the knowledge for the various initiatory rites, the knowledge to bring forth an apprentice to initiate the various offices, shall we say, positions of power, and from which to initiate people who will successfully undertake the correct initiations, and they have to be correct, and the correct transmutations at these various temples, who can then go away and open a pillar of fire. That's all going to be, if not released in the Altar of Sacrifice, then there is a lot coming in the Witch Blood Grail, as well as a lot of other knowledge of larger sacrificial rites and things like that. But the Mother Temple is the vehicle of transmission for the Atlantean current, untempered, direct into the inner planes of this world. This is the largest vortex at this time through which this current is transmitted into the inner planes. And it's a physical manifestation. It's an actual structure in the Spanish mountains. It's opened through the inner planes through the work granted. It's opened in sacrifice. There is no other way. They have to be opened in vortices of death, these gateways, so that the vortex is opened in a gate of death. And the actual methodology for that, it requires 8 sacrifices in one very in-depth ritual sitting, and it's a long preparation and a lot of power and energy and a long night's work to inaugurate the opening of the temple successfully to bring the Atlantean current through. That was done a few years ago now. That was 3 years ago the temple was ignited, and that current's been flowing through since. Within the temple, for those that come, they may be initiated within that Atlantean flame, bearing in mind that I am the butler, the gatekeeper. I'm just the fellow that opens the door. It is Hecate, it is Lucifer, it is Belial, it is Sephirant, the Atlantean gods, and the myriad of other spirits, including the very ancient spirits of the forest of the place, the spirits of the depths, various chimera entities. It depends on the initiation, it depends on the person, it depends on what path and what gateway is being opened for them. I'm simply the person that ignites the rite as gatekeeper to that temple at this time. The temple does not belong to me. Curator be the right word? Caretaker. Okay.
Caretaker.
There is a view of a temple apprentice, but this person must undertake this path of their own free will. The right person at the right time will be brought along to replace the current gatekeeper, but the temple will stand long after this incarnation of mine has passed. So you've got Primal Craft Occult Publishing, which transmits the literary word and manifests the, once they're consecrated correctly, the gateways of the book, etc. And then you have the Mother Temple as the physical and spiritual manifestation of the actual gateway back to the Atlantean plains itself, and all the teaching in between. Then you have various people doing various tasks, the garden being one. There are people that have various different groups around the world. There's one in the West Indies, there's quite a few in the United States. Some of these people take this work, they work purely within themselves, and if they need any, occasionally, if there's some discussion within the groups to how something should be done or performed, then they'll come to me. And then there are other people that come to me regularly and directly for knowledge and for teaching, or just general guidance and assistance. If I don't have it to hand, then, you know, in my own head, within my own consciousness and my own knowledge, then it's a matter of opening myself up, which I can do there and then. I do speak to people on Skype. I do speak to if needs be. I prefer to keep the correspondence by email solely as a matter of time, because I do this all the time, and it is very time consuming and it's a labour of love, but I have to prioritise people. So, but if someone, I have had people who have had difficulty or who have had problems, I will speak to them on Skype. There is no financial interest in this. I don't charge, I don't believe in charging. The books are the only things that anyone has to pay for, because they're costly to have manifested and to publish, and basically the book covers the next book's publication, etc., etc. Regarding initiation, regarding advice, teaching, time, anything like that, there is no financial exchange. Hecate doesn't want me to manage it that way, and I personally don't believe in doing that. Nothing against the people that do, but it's not the way we work here at Primal Craft. So that as a whole is Primal Craft as the witchcraft foundation through which the primal current, Hecate's witch flame, is being returned in knowledge, in teaching, and in practicality for different people around the world now. And people are now coming, taking this work, and they're being given knowledge.
Sure.
Some people have merely taken hold of, for instance, the Red King or the Scorpion God or Queen of Hell, and they're being given knowledge, and they're working. Some of them connect to Primal Craft and the Primal Craft Foundation directly, others don't. And you know, I get a brief overview of what they're doing. Sometimes they're just looking to share this knowledge, to, you know, to connect, to say, oh, we're actually doing this, but they're so engrossed in what they're doing. And the idea of this work is direct contact. The idea is not for myself to try and attain as much kudos within the occult field as possible. You'll notice I don't indulge in Facebook. I don't get involved in Twitter, and it's enough that I occasionally pop up on the occasional forum to defend the work or to answer questions, etc. Sometimes that's necessary. You have to speak your piece or to clarify matters. But the work as a whole and the purpose of the work is not about Mark Alan Smith. The work as a whole is about the primal craft and the primal current. I have been given this rule by Hecate. The sole purpose, or the greatest initial gateway, is to initiate direct current between the practitioner, the devotee, the initiate, and the gods and the spirits themselves. And I've seen very often people have got that, and then they don't need me anymore, and they're working, and that's the point.
Yeah, that's
if you're getting taught direct by Hecate, you don't need me. Sometimes people come, after a couple of years, I'll hear from someone, and it's very much a case, you can see they're deeply involved in some very heavy transmutational work, and sometimes they come to connect purely for a little bit of a little bit of balance and confirmation. It's very powerful to have confirmation sometimes from an incarnate mundane source, and that just keeps them balanced. Sometimes it's a little bit of sanity balance. They're so enraptured and encapsulated with this energy that it helps to balance the person and their mind to get back in touch or to speak to someone else about it. And so that I'll get the odd correspondence from someone I haven't heard from for a couple of years. There are people that are regularly, week in, week out. They, you know, different people require different things and are at different levels of the work. But it's nice to see someone I haven't heard for a couple of years. They come forward and you can feel the energy coming off the email. They're so involved in what they're doing, and they're actually only getting in contact for a little bit of balance, for a little bit of confirmation, to assure their own sanity, because the energy that they've got, the contact they've got, is so intense and it's so powerful. But that's good. And it's equally rewarding to see these people, they no longer need me, because their teaching is direct from Hecate. And when I first began this work, that was the ethos with which I initiated the writing and everything else. It was never about me as a person. It's about the work and it's about Hecate. And the biggest reward is seeing that you've, you know, sometimes very easily accomplished that through a few ritual introductions, and someone's got direct contact and they're getting their teaching direct from source. And in that way, to be not needed is actually very, very rewarding.
I can imagine that. Yes.
There's always new people.
Right.
As you know, there's always someone new who comes forward and who needs a little bit of assistance, and then their gateway opens. And they've, you know, you've got people, you've got some very experienced people that come to this path, and so it might be a little bit different with them. But even with total beginners, you get these people that come and they've, you know, they're still struggling with the concept of talking to a god or a goddess. Or they have initial fears, as quite a few people do, of say Belial, because they've not walked that path per se. And then when you see them and they're writing back and you've got these huge emails, they're getting all of this knowledge, and the next thing they're going off into the rocky cliffs and the coastline to build a temple for Belial and things like that. There's lots of that happening. That in itself is watching the work expand. So Primal Craft, in that way, it's nice to see it's not judged solely by the volume of work that I put out. I've got literally decades of publishing work to put forward. I'm backlogged, perhaps, with the volume of knowledge that I've got, and I'm working all the time. At this moment in time, I might have 20 years worth of written work to put forward, and it will take, that could take 25 or 30 years. At the moment, I've managed to get one book out per year, but that's working to the clappers. That's head down, ass in the air, and working very, very hard to get this out whilst, you know, maintaining the level of teaching and instruction, and whilst maintaining my own path and my own knowledge, because I'm still learning every single day and working, you know, this path, and working, soaking up as much as I can. Perhaps for some slightly different reasons, at the end of it, with the level of knowledge and power within my own soul, I hope to be able to make my own personal contribution to the world soul at energy level. But it's not something I want to get too deep into at this moment in time. However, that's the all-encompassing role of Primal Craft. So to see it grow within the work, the groups, the practices, and not only that, the devotion to people are now starting to be given knowledge of. They're given individual instruction. They're given,
sure.
Belial's come forward. You need to build a temple for me. And he's given people these instructions. And now Sephiranz, particularly with the altar of sacrifice, she really began showing herself with the scorpion god when her Atlantean manifestation was, shall we say, unshackled by Hecate. Sephiranz can be identified by some as the Babylonian fire goddess. She is within the realm and sphere and aeon of man. She is the apocalyptic goddess. She is the daughter of war, conquest, and flame. Within the Atlantean inner planes, she is the ruler of the primal gods. And before the era of man, it was Sephiranz who ruled this world, the body of Belial. It was Sephiranz who oversaw the development and the progression and the evolution of the great reptiles. You know, about 600 million years or so, 650 million years. I keep saying this, I'm not a paleontologist, so I don't know. You know, all those hundreds of millions of years where the great reptiles, the dinosaurs, walked this earth when man himself has been here, certainly no more than 100,000 years. The gods, the beings, the primal gods, the entities, their primal knowledge, all of that power could be tapped. That was Sephiranz. Okay, she ruled over the 11 primal gods. There are many more beings, many more spirits, many more gods, but what we're identifying with at this moment in time are the key crown holders, the highest elements. When you identify with them, they bring forth the myriad of other gods and spirits, and there are thousands, if not more than that, that are all individual teachers but you identify with the crown, you identify with the Kate, with Lucifer, with Belial, with Sephiroth, that they bring forth the different gods, the different teachers, the different beings, and open the different gateways for you, because you are offering your devotion unto them, unto their throne, unto their crown, unto them as a being. So you've got Sephiroth, who holds office as the daughter of war, conquest, and fire. Sephiroth, who will, if man does not rebalance the world soul, rebalance it by force, rebalance it with cataclysm, rebalance it with a second fall. If we fall again, and we will, if the world soul is not rebalanced, therefore I reiterate, we will fall again, because the world soul will not be rebalanced by man in 344 years' time, when it is weighed by Lucifer, then there will be a second fall. This fall will not be because of spiritual corruption, it will be because of the corruption on the mundane plane that has unbalanced the world soul, the destruction of the planet, its poisoning, the toxicity, the greed, the genocide, and all of the other heinous atrocities committed by mankind in the name of greed and the attainment of what I would call false power. It may be power within this realm. When that is wiped away through tectonic shift, volcanic eruption, and tsunami, it will be by the hands of Sephiroth and Belial conjoined as the great goddess of war, conquest, and flame, and the beast risen and conjoined. It is their conjoined energies that do this. That is Sephiroth's aspect in the Aeon of Man. To digress slightly from that, for those that wish to tap power that was held before the incarnation of man, power of the reptilian realm, all of the instinct, all of the everything that was transmitted to every living creature from the first beings that crawled out of the ocean and developed through evolution into the great reptiles, how to eat, how to fight, how to reproduce, how to hunt, how to protect, was delivered ensorcelled in instinct from the primal gods. That instinct, that energy through which ensorcelled this, its power, its magical power, its primal, its raw, for approximately 600 million years it's reptilian, but it's connected to mankind. We have that connection, that gateway within our brain, our mind, which is the microcosm of the macrocosmic universe. That energy is turbulent, it is untempered, but it can be tapped. And what can be tapped, if it can be adapted, and it can, and in source sort, can be unleashed. Look at all of the magic, I digress, but look at all the magic and all the spiritual power that we're looking to tap and open now. That's the sum of man's existence. So no more than 100,000 years of energy, raw magical energy. Okay, yes, within that you've got different fields, different pantheons, different gods to connect to, different forms of spiritual gnosis. But as a whole, it's raw magical energy. So 100,000 years. Now try looking at tapping 600 million years worth of energy, of instinct, delivered from primal gods onto animal, onto mammal. You know, the very surface of that would be the different animal forms. And there you're off into shape-shifting and various other things, which, you know, instinct is integrated in that when you follow those paths. Okay? Now imagine it at a far deeper level. Sephiroth, who is the fourth flame, the fourth god of the trident, of which flame you have the three upper flames, Belial, Lucifer, and Hecate, and then Sephiroth in the depths. She commands that. She is gatekeeper and custodian to all of that power and knowledge. Through the reintroduction of the Atlantean current, her deeper aspect, okay, which is the Atlantean queen that ruled over these reptiles, that ruled the earth before the creation of man, before his formation at the hands of Lucifer, is now unbound and reintegrated with the aspect that is known to us as the Babylonian Fire Queen, as the apocalyptic goddess, as the daughter, the great daughter of Hecate and Lucifer, the daughter of war, conquest, and flame. Those two aspects, by the hand and will of Hecate, are now reintegrated. So Sephiroth is now slowly starting to approach people. And it shows when people are purchasing, for instance, the altar of sacrifice, and they take custody of it. There's one gentleman, he's got this powerful, sensual, raw, dark female entity coming up clicking through the gateway of the book and taking a hold of him and transmitting energy and power and knowledge. That's between Sepharans and this gentleman, but she's choosing people the way Hecate chose me for this work. Belial is doing something similar, but the point I'm making is that she's now becoming more prevalent, more prominent in the sphere of man, and that's going to expand, and it's all to do with the awakening of the reawakening of the Atlantean current, the reawakening age. And when I say the reawakening age, what I'm getting at is reawakening man to the true source of magic, and reawakening man to step outside of his self-imposed or hierarchy-imposed bubble, to look outside the box and to see what's happening, and to connect with the true sources of power, the gods, and to take some action towards it, to do proactive work. That's the age of reawakening.
Well, with that, you've mentioned that we will fail, we will fall. Yes, and I know that comes through prophecy. I understand that through many of the books there are prophecies. Is there a certain book that you have put up, or that you could actually elaborate on how and where all the prophecies through everything? Because I get the notion that not all the prophecies are within the books.
They're not all within the books. It's taking me time to get the prophecies out.
I kind of sense that. So if you could just elaborate on how that's received and how you're actually going to help those out there, because this is something that I feel that is very important. I mean, you know, a book is one thing, but, you know, the power is one thing, but without the insight, I do feel that many of us are lost.
Okay. The prophecies, I began releasing them within the Red King. The reason that there aren't so many in Queen of Hell is Queen of Hell is the introductory gateway. It's also, you've pointed out, and quite a few people have pointed out to me that they've noticed, it's also very much documentation of my own personal path to empowerment at that time. So while there may have been some prophecies coming through at that time, Queen of Hell, it wasn't appropriate to release them. They began in the Red King. Now, the Red King and the Scorpion God are the first initial prophecies. The ones that are blatant, it's very simple. As I've explained, and I won't go into it all again, the World Sword being out of balance and why it's out of balance, and the need to work with the gods to rebalance it. The World Soul, as the collective unconsciousness, as the, let's call it the aura, the soul of the planet itself, it's not the consciousness of Belial, it's the sum of our actions and the spiritual energy connected to our collective unconsciousness that is dramatically out of balance, and as above, so below, one sets the other out of balance. Therefore, it's man that's unbalanced the World Soul, for the aforementioned reasons. You would only have to turn on the television, the radio, to look at the news to see everything that's going on, and it's worse now than it ever was. The World Soul will be weighed by the hand of Lucifer outside the circulating time colours, okay? Circles of time, for want of a better expression, it's one of Kenneth Grant's expressions. But the time colours, the formula with which time is measured and progression is allowed within our world, and to a certain extent within the universe, although you start getting out to the outer edges of that, it becomes less important, because time becomes less relevant there. Outside of the world, outside of the universe itself, in the void, the World Soul will be weighed by Lucifer. If it's still out of balance in 344 years' time, what you're seeing at the moment, the volcanic reaction, the tsunamis that have increased in recent years, the tectonic shifts, will increase to a cataclysmic level. And it will reduce the race of man. And this is in prophecy, to exactly the amount of incarnate souls as there were at the end of the Atlantean fall. Exactly the amount of incarnate souls. I can't qualify that. That is purely from prophecy. I can present you with nothing other than the prophecy itself at this time as an incarnate person, which is why it's been put forward in the books. It's written in black and white in the Red King and the Scorpion God, although the time scale is different. 345, 344 years for each book respectively, as they were published a couple of years ago. the time scale and the prophecies are accurate because they were given accurately. They're not ambiguous. They're specific as to what will happen. So yes, it's easy for me to sit here and put forward a prophecy, because there were always going to be naysayers and there are always going to be people that doubt. Fine, those people can continue, but for those of us that want to work, that actually want to do something about this, we need to move them out of the way and forget about them and be proactive about this. And those of us who have the courage to step outside of our magical bubble, to put your neck on the guillotine, to put forward prophecy, okay, while you're incarnate, while we're going to do this work, while we're here to try and do something about it, always sit back and do nothing. All I can tell you is from these prophecies that if we sit back and do nothing, there is going to be a lot of smashed humanity, more than man has ever seen, because there are more people to be wiped away. When the numbers of man have been reduced, the world soul will, by effect, be defaulted. It will be rebalanced. It will be rebalanced by default, by the removal, the reduction of the numbers of man, because it will bring humanity together. Such will be the size and catastrophe and devastation of these cataclysmic events. There will be no individual governments. There will only be one united human race, but a lot of men, women, and a lot of children, our descendants, our children's children, our great-great-great-grandchildren, they're going to be destroyed, and a lot of the world itself will be refashioned and reshaped. To say it will be for the greater good is easy to speak the words and to pay lip service to it, but for what the human race is doing to other species, to the planet itself, it will be. Therefore, the warnings are being put forth now. Yes, the books are in limited number, but for those that would say, well, you know, you're only doing 999 books, but books are a limited number. If I were to stand on CNN and give you these prophecies, would it really make a difference? Would it be listened to? The purpose of these books and this knowledge and these prophecies is to put it forward to the small few who will take this and work with it and empower themselves and work directly with the gods. In doing that, you may be asked to open some rituals. There are rituals within the altar of sacrifice that raise large waves. There are rituals that are clearly designed to invoke the power of the gods, to call the gods forth from their thrones and initiate cataclysmic events. There will be people who may be naysayers towards this. If you don't have the faith in your work and you don't believe that you're able or capable to do that, then by all means enjoy reading it and pass it on to someone who does, or make your own opinion of it. But for those people who have the faith in their own power, the connection to the gods, the reason that these things are being asked for is to enhance the warnings. If the warnings are heeded and enough people work, then perhaps the damage can be reduced, its damage limitation. But in doing that, you need to take the work seriously, because if you don't lose sleep, if you don't sit up, if you don't actually contemplate, it's easy for the egomaniacs, it's easy to ride the crest of a wave, no pun intended, of summoning something like a tsunami to bring forth this warning and marvel at their own power. It's the power of the gods. You're merely initiating the question, the petition, the rite. And if you're doing that without actually suffering within your own consciousness and your own mind of the devastation and the loss of life, then you may find that reflects upon your own soul. There's a huge, huge tangential subject to all of this. The subject matter is vast and it's a lot to contemplate. It will be too much for most people. And it can actually be quite difficult and sanity stretching to merely bring through this work. I've done enough work, I've worked closely enough and strongly and intrinsically enough with Hecate to have been fashioned to be strong enough to do this, but it doesn't mean that it doesn't cause me problems, because it does. It causes me distress, especially when I can see a lot of what's going to happen. I can see where these prophecies are going, and I can sometimes see the end results of some of these prophecies. But if I sit back and do nothing and I sit on this work, then what am I? That's just cowardice. It takes a little bit more than that. It takes absolute commitment, absolute devotion to her, to this work, to this world. And to be fair, although there is a lot of cataclysmic destruction and the initiation of such within works such as the altar of sacrifice, to my fellow man, because if these works aren't paid heed to, then what will happen in 343, 344 years' time will be absolutely catastrophic, and the loss of life will be vast. How many? 7 billion people on the world now. To reduce that to the number of incarnate souls that there were after the first fall, that's not millions, that's billions. That's a lot of tectonic shifts. That's huge continent shifting. That's volcanic activity. That's what's coming to rebalance the world soul at the hands of Sephirans and Belial in those roles to ensure that we don't destroy this planet, to ensure that we don't destroy ourselves. The reduction of numbers of the human race will be fast, but in the end, it will prevent us from destroying ourselves, because we're also very close to doing that. There are many different apocalyptic keys, many gateways to this. The prophecies of the timeline I've given, they're written in the books and they're written there in black and white. What a lot of people don't see is the specifics of how this will happen.
Hmm.
And those prophecies are woven. They're in the Red King, but much more so in the Scorpion God, and very much so in the altar of sacrifice, within the evocations, within the prayers. They're not just gateways calling the gods and the spirits forth. They're not just evocations and not just prayers. They are prophecies, statements, vivid, accurate, prophesized descriptions of what is expected to happen if the world soul is not brought back into balance, and how it will be delivered. Some of them are through raised waves, some of them are through volcanoes, but it's not purely through the physical manifestation of this destruction. The evocations and the prayers within the book contain the detail of the being, the entity, and the reason at those specific moments behind it, followed by the actual physical manifestation of whatever particular cataclysmic event it is, and the result. So the prophecies will expand throughout various different books. Will I bring forward one book totally of all those prophecies? No. It just doesn't feel... I haven't been prompted to do that. Unless Sakate comes forward and, you know, requests some kind of more specific, but especially because the timelines here are very specific, Nostradamus-type book, solely of prophecies, then no, there's no need for that, because they're not going to solve anything on their own. What you've got with books like The Altar of Sacrifice is a path, an ability to open different temples, an ability to reintegrate the way of sacrifice and all that that entails, an ability to empower the soul with this. Also, there is the knowledge of igniting the thrones of the gods and manifesting those vortices within this world. Within that, concurrent and parallel and tangential to that, you also have the ability to effect change, to initiate more warnings. They may be cataclysmic events, they may be tremors within the inner planes, and warnings. There may be the bringing forth of more souls. That work is within the altar of sacrifice itself. So what we have is the prophecies interwoven with the practical application of spiritual evolution, spiritual transmutation, and the ability to actually, for those people who have the faith in themselves, that they have the faith that they have that genuine connection with the gods, to be able to do this work and apply these rituals. Because when you look at some of these rites, they're large, they're not small. The rituals, I'm speaking specifically about the actual rites of the very special seals of Belial, Lucifer, and Hecate, and Sephirans. The formation, myself, I've already formed my own individual sets of these seals and requested these vortices and sat and deliberated and accepted that any destruction that is resultant from them is for the greater good. That's the individual's choice. Those people that do not believe that that is possible, those people that do not have enough faith in themselves or in their own personal power, may continue to work towards that, or they may not wish to go anywhere near it, okay? But for people who understand that their spiritual path and their spiritual power and this knowledge, it is not something that is within a self-contained bubble.
Right.
It's not some fantasy. It's intrinsic to the world, that the witchcraft is intrinsic to the human condition. The magic can be grounded through the body, grounded through gateways, grounded through this earth, to understand that we're not spectators in the evolution of this planet. We're participants in its evolution or in its destruction. With the people who have the faith and the devotion and the courage to carry that forward, the work is now being given and returned through me, through other people, through these vehicles written, through the initiation at the Mother Temple and various other vortices that will, over the next few years, be opened to do something about it. And so the prophecies are interwoven with that. To merely put forward a book solely of the prophecies would be losing valuable time.
Yes.
And you know, give them the tools to do something about it is what Akatu wants me to do and wants us to do, is to give people the formula and the methodology. It's no good crying for, excuse me. It's no good chanting for revolution if you're not actually going to partake of revolution. If you're going to partake upon it on the mundane plane, then you're going to face the various different governmental agencies at best. Or you're going to get stopped, and when I say stopped, I mean hard stop, I mean killed, at worst. I'm not advocating that you do or you don't do this. I'm simply saying that chanting about it, that copying things in from other people's feeds, is not revolution, and you cannot then hide behind the, well, we're trying to whip people up. If you're going to partake of it, partake of it. As a former professional soldier, of a full career in the British Army of 13 years, I am not interested in partaking of any kind of Guy Fawkes type revolution, because I know it will be put down very quickly, and it's not the role I've been chosen for. Mm. What I have is the ability to put forward the magical formula that allowed people to do something perhaps far more devastating.
Right.
Than I have nothing. I hold nothing against people that protest, and I have nothing against activists. Something needs to be done. These people are needed. But there are a lot of people that jump on the bandwagon, that wave the banner, but that don't actually, are not willing to get their hands dirty. That's their choice. It's not my path. What I've been given is the formula and the ability to actually give people, the people that will commit to this, that can raise the sort of energy, that are devoted enough, and who can carry the weight in their hearts of their actions of this devastation, and be proactive and do something about this and try and turn this around before the gods do it for us in 344 years time. Now, what I did want to say about the prophecies was, again, to be honest, if you're a naysayer, it doesn't matter. There will always be people who have separate opinions. That's good. That's part of free will. At least that still exists in some corners of the world. To the casual observer, it's easy to put forth prophecies when, in this incarnation, I'm not going to be there in 343 and 344 years' time. I don't have the time for justification. I only have the time to put forward the worksheet she gives me. So I can accept now in one sentence people to say, yes, well, you know, it's easy for you to put that forward and you could be wrong. Okay, yes, and I wholeheartedly believe that I'm not. And that the direct connection that I have with Akate, what she's giving me, is genuine. So what if I'm not wrong? What if I'm right? At the very least, if we don't make it, and the cataclysmic events take place, and the human race is reduced, if only a few copies of these books, or the memory of the knowledge of these books survives, then it serves as a reminder, as a warning. This knowledge is real. It has been seen before. It was put forth almost 3.5 centuries ago, and we ignored it. We cannot allow this to happen again.
Mm. That's really huge, given, you know, it's on the track of being so accurate.
Yeah.
On the track of the devastation and, you know, just pretty much the ruin of you know, what we are going to become or not. That's a lot of work for a small unit, a small, let's say, fellowship, a small group of devotees.
It is.
Being the gods are huge. Being the gods have a lot of power. One has to ask, why, through man, would even Hecate actually go to the source through humanity because of the devotion and the connection, you know, what we get from her, what we get from the gods is huge. So why not actually lean towards them a little bit more through the primal craft?
We are, but it's about working together. Within all of this, you have choice and free will.
Mm-hmm.
As a race, as a generalization, which isn't fair, but it happens to be true, mankind, we as mankind, have chosen to wipe out species,
mm-hmm.
to dump toxic waste, to have however many square miles of horrible plastic flooding in the Pacific, to destroy this planet, to destroy each other. That's our choice. If we sit back and do nothing and don't try to rebalance the world, so the gods will, as I mentioned, rebalance it for us. This knowledge, this power is put forward to give people, even if it is only a few, the chance, the choice to do something about this, to work hand in hand with the gods. That choice is viewed. We are watched, we are scrutinized. You have to bear in mind that one of the things that Hecate gave to me a few years ago now was that one of the purposes of the human race was to be the possibility, their souls, after many, many millennia of evolution, a very few select souls at spiritual level would be the could be the possible next race of gods. There is more than one universe.
Of course.
When this universe comes to an end, and this is something that will be that the actual methodology, the formula, shall we say, what will happen when this universe ends will be covered in the Witchblood Grail. Again, the stellar knowledge is something that I have to weave in within the prophecies, within the practical application of the work, excuse me, and everything else. So it comes in sequence, but you get a little bit of each, as much as I can release at any one time. If I was to hold any one element for its own singular book, you might wait 20 years for one book. So I release it as it is relevant within the work and at the time scale that it comes through to me. For instance, when this universe ends, it will implode. When it implodes, it will then explode in several different vortices throughout the void.
Sure.
What would be known as the Big Bang Theory, igniting the birth of other universes along within the measurement of time. A long, long time from now, the very, very evolved souls, those souls that evolved past the level of what you would call ascended masters, have the possibility to be the next race of gods, or souls at certain levels will be ascended masters that will then be given the role of transmitting energy and knowledge to a developing race that may not be a human race within a separate universe. We're into the very deeper aspects of the stellar bodies of the gods, and their larger, their bigger picture, their intentions, future intentions, if you want to put it in a linear terms of time scale, within future, okay? But one of the purposes of mankind is the possibility from a select amount of highly evolved souls could be, another race, maybe not the next race, another race of higher evolved spiritual forms. Gods is probably not a great word, okay, higher evolved spiritual forms, but please bear in mind, we have been here, as stated, 100,000 years,
yes,
or something like that. We are not indispensable. Therefore, it needs to occur to people that maybe the reason that some of this knowledge is being put forward is to see what we will do with it, to see if we will actually take up spiritual arms and be proactive and try and reverse the damage that we as a race have done, or will we just pay lip service to it like we do everything else and sit back, in which case you won't need to open any rituals to rebalance the world, so it will be rebalanced for us.
Right.
Yes. So yeah, and again, it's something I'd like to stress, that the work, when you look at the apocalyptic keys, will be covered in greater detail in the Witchblood Grail, which is the book that comes after the Altar of Sacrifice, along with the Eighth Crown of Belial and Sephiroth's Eighth Crown, which is an incredibly destructive process. It's an empowerment of the goddess of war, conquest, and flame. It's an empowerment of the apocalyptic great daughter, and basically the hand of Hecate and Lucifer unleashing her across the face of this earth, which brings us to the rebalancing or not of the world saw them in 344 years time. That will be covered in greater detail, but there are rituals, there are powers and formula and abilities and the gateways through which such may be petitioned for to raise walls of water, to create shakes, tectonic shifts, to bring forth the warnings. Okay, you can sit and argue, man won't listen, or you can bring forth this knowledge and or apply and do something about it. I put it to you that whatever your view of this, be it this path or another, if you sit and do nothing, you are but a spectator to something that is, in one way, shape, form or another, the prophecies that I've brought through aside, inevitable. And that is tantamount to either selfishness in the best scale or cowardice in the worst. To be honest, neither of which I subscribe to. I'm very far from perfect, but I'm neither of those. So that's why this formula is being brought forward. When you look at the formula, understand that, yes, you have to have a level of experience and power to open these gateways, but it is not you that is raising a wall of water if you're petitioning Belial or Lucifer to do it. It is them. This is the formula for such a petition. Therefore, it's actually very, very attainable.
I think you've made it very clear as to what Primal Craft is overall. The thing is that people can bottle it and put it over here and put it over there, but it's of its essence, the actual origin and where, you know, where it all comes from. I'd like for you to explain the difference between the gnosis of what you've received and stellar knowledge that comes through.
Okay.
Because when you're talking about information coming by God and through possession, what have you, that is the gnosis you've received.
Yeah.
And the stellar knowledge, too, can be received in the same way. Or perhaps I'm not understanding.
No, it is. It very much is. It's, again... What we have, or what we had until the return of the primal current, was at best fragmented. So you've got knowledge of the infernal realms and the realms within the earth, okay, down to the throne of Belial, at the heart of this very planet that is his body, okay? You've got knowledge of the draconian elementals, the draconian lines, you've got knowledge of the ethers and the empyrean realms, you've got knowledge of the Atlantean depths. And then you have got the stellar knowledge, the starry wisdom, the stellar gateways. A lot of that was lost. I think after the Atlantean fall, you'll see that probably the Egyptians appear to have the majority of what was left. And I say the majority of what was left because it was very fragmented. But this was knowledge that was held by the priesthood and the practicing faiths of the very first civilized cultures that antedate the Egyptian culture, you know, so before the fall, 20,000 or 22,000 years ago, when it was perhaps, if I said at its peak, might be the best way to describe it, but it would suffice. Then you had stellar wisdom, starry wisdom, the knowledge of very spiritual gateways, the knowledge that when you performed certain rituals, you opened certain gateways within the mind, that the brain being the physical manifestation of such within the mind, that are connected to stellar gateways out in the universal body of Lucifer. Okay, so the opening of those, an opening of gateways within the soul, the mind and the soul being a macrocosmic form of the greater universal body in which we dwell, that's all part of the starry wisdom. That comes through concurrently. It very much depends. So there are gateways that can be opened. There are stellar realms that can be explored, but also these currents can be earthed. And that's, it begins in the Red King through Lucifer. If you see, there are, people are now starting to correlate that within the witchcraft, the wolf and the goddess and the great dragon and the great beast and the devil, they've always been in sort of not traditional, more traditional witchcraft, I say that, as opposed to pigeonholing it to what's known as traditional witchcraft. In the more traditional terms of witchcraft itself, you know, they're prominent figures. But then if you look and tap the more stellar elements of, say, the primal craft, you'll see the Lord of the Dark Star, the wolf-headed god, a form of Lucifer as the Dark Star, the keeper of the threshold, or a form of Belial and Lucifer conjoined. The keeper of the threshold, the gateway to the abyss, a wolf-headed god. Now, if you look at correlations to, say, what they thought was the jackal-headed god in Anubis, who was also a gatekeeper, and I'm not a historian or an Egyptologist, but I think most people with a basic grasp would be able to see there's an awful lot of stellar lore interwoven in there.
Definitely.
It's merely a comment, but people are now starting to question whether that is actually a jackal-headed entity or a wolf-headed entity, brought up recently by some jackal-headed. You can see correlations there. Okay, but the starry wisdom, the stellar knowledge, it comes through concurrent. It's equally as important. These are all currents, they're all strands, they're all a part of the greater body of power and knowledge that is the primal craft that comes from the original source of all creation. The supreme dark magical power, the supreme feminine power, the supreme dark goddess in the void, who identified herself as Hecate, okay, bringing forth this primal craft. Other people, other cultures in millennia gone past may know her by different names. That's not really what's important now. What's important is how she's identified herself and what she actually is. This all stems from her. Okay.
Right. You know, you mentioned the dark goddess. You mentioned a lot of darkness here. Mm. But you know what? I don't see it that way. In a way, you know, I do see it in one aspect.
I mention it as a polarity. I mention it as a, if you were to step outside of, say, this the solar system of this universe, where that particular body, the sun itself, okay, gives light. Then, other than what's radiated off other stars or other light coming from those other stars, it's dark. Out in the void, there is no light unless you're looking for Lucifer himself.
Okay? Indeed.
Therefore, also it's mentioned as a polarity, so people can understand. Also, you have to understand that we've not just lost a lot through the false man-made paternal solar cults that have been initiated, created, and fabricated as franchises to, you know, either keep the poor happy or keep the majority controlled, etc., etc. It's not a case of losing a lot. We've actually, you know, we've had a lot that we didn't want that isn't accurate put upon us. So I have to be very careful when describing this. But if you look at the feminine power, which is what Hecate is, that is darkness. That is the left.
Mm.
Okay. And there has to be some form of terminology to describe this, but she exists out in the void. The true throne of Hecate is out in the void. It's not within the universe of man. That is an entity, a being, a primal draconian form that is of pure, dark, magical power. You're looking, if your telescopes are now only just starting to clock things like dark matter, there is a tendency with neo-pagans and within the set to pick something and by way of justifying whatever they're doing or whatever they're trying to explain, pick it to pieces. Okay?
Sure.
So I neither condemn nor advocate Wicca, because it has its place and it can serve as a gateway for other things, and there are people that have attained a lot of power through Wicca and they're very happy with what they're doing. I would no more condemn, and I'm aware of its flaws as I'm aware of my own. I would no more condemn Wicca than I would condemn Islam or anything else. No, I'm not fond of paternal solar cults. That goes without saying. I think they get a mention because of the way they're managed and because of the governing bodies, etc. However, there is a tendency for people in their justification of things to pick something apart. So now you can't use certain terminology without being pulled about it. If someone says black magic, someone will always say, well, yes, but what's the difference between, you know, there is no black or white. We know that. So sometimes when they're talking about black magic, they might be talking about selfish magic, self-orientated things, or malefica. Or something that's held with, that's not held out in the daylight realms, like pinned on a lamppost with all its knowledge on doorstep type religion. Would you like to buy a copy of whatever at your doorstep from a religious document? It has to be attained in direct contact through the inner planes. You'll find that these areas may be blood-soaked tunnels if you're heading through the tunnels of Lilith or Hecate in certain realms, or even out into the stellar areas. If you're heading out into the void, if you begin traveling through stellar gateways, without the guidance of Lucifer, your soul will become lost and will not come back, particularly if you venture through certain gateways in certain final initiation rites that exit the soul under the guidance of the gods, but it is a huge soul test from the existence of this universe. Out there, it's black. Mm. It's the void. So what exists out there is, at least to the human perception and eye, black.
Indeed.
Okay? It is not the best description I can give, but I think it covers why. So when you say dark, then people will jump on you for darkness's sake, or
of course.
There's a lot of terminology. There's an awful lot of people jumping on things purely to justify the knowledge that they feel that they have, that they're putting forward. Okay, it doesn't stop me using what I believe is the correct terminology. Mm-hmm. So when I'm talking about man, I'm talking about the soul. As most people know, each soul is bisexualized. It's formed of male and female. A soul, like an angelic being, although they're not the same thing, is androgynous.
Mm.
And you have the male element and the female element.
Sure.
And the male element is solar, and the female element is lunar at a lower level. Therefore, you have the brightness, okay?
Of course.
Not saying that all men are bright and shining. I'm sure the ladies would disagree. And the female element, you have the darkness. Now, Lucifer has the capacity for immense darkness, for immense black acts. Lucifer, if a soul is devoted and he considers a soul worthy, will elevate that soul. And he is brilliant. He is shining. He is stellar flame. But it does not alter the fact that he can manifest in a very, very dark persona. And if necessary, he can tear a soul to pieces. Not all souls. There's also this view that souls are, it's all forgiven when you pass over, and all souls are good. No, all souls are not good. They are the sum of the acts of many incarnations, and some of them are, you know, inherently not good these days. Therefore, if a soul is not worthy and it undertakes a final initiation, then it is Lucifer's role to judge that. As he would judge the world soul, he will judge the microcosmic individual soul. If it's judged unworthy, then it is condemned. And that is what you may class, I guess the Christians would call it, damned. These are rituals that people will enter of their own free will. Okay? That could be classed as maybe not a malefic act, a black act, a dark act. It's certainly not a kind act. It's a necessary act. Okay? It's a matter of perspective. So it's a terminology, it's a name, it's a description, it's a method of conveying. However, while you can't see on camera, is that a normal mirror over there?
I wouldn't say no.
It's a, what type of mirror? A dark mirror?
Yes.
There you go. To describe it as a mirror would be incorrect.
I see, just
it's
saying,
a dark
yes,
mirror.
Yes.
You need to be able to convey, you need that the words are a vehicle for which to convey, you know, certain descriptions, you know, to the best of our human understanding. But Hecate is the pure, raw, feminine current and the supreme dark goddess that exists in the void. When she created Lucifer, then she breathed something into that, tore something from herself, and that became pure, blinding, stellar flame. There are some people within the witchcraft that will use that to describe how Lucifer being so blinding that his shadow is black.
Hmm.
It's so bright. But there's many different ways of looking at it. But that's probably, it's not the perfect way of describing it, but it was a good question, because it's allowed me to convey something that's a little bit of a bone that I wanted to pick with terminology. You know, it's the world, you know, people go on about political correctness.
Indeed.
You can't say this and you can't say that. The occult fraternity is becoming the same. You can't use this terminology, you can't. without someone working on it. It doesn't stop me.
I have to drink to that. Because yeah. I have to circumvent it. It really irks me. Yes, indeed.
You need to. I need to convey what I need to convey. So the terminology that I find correct in doing that is the terminology that I use. And I can't think of anything better than the Dark Goddess or the first Primal Dragon of the Void or the Supreme Dark Goddess. That's Hecate. You know? That's... And she has many facets within that. Invincible Queen of the Dead, Queen of the Heavens and the Earths, Queen of Hell. Okay, so again, all covered by that. But at source, at her most powerful, primal and original manifestation, that's what I would call the Primal Dragon of the Void or the Supreme Dark Goddess.
You know, you mentioned that there are lots of things that are lost, lots of knowledge, perhaps even gods. The information behind that.
In the gods themselves.
Yes, in the gods themselves.
Yes, quite possibly.
How much is missing? Because I do know that there's lots that you have not put into the books as of yet.
Right.
And you won't be, you know, as you mentioned, you do have that task to carry on
a
different realm at some point, hopefully very late. How much of it have you not put into the books that's present today that you could possibly bring out even today to let people know? Because the thing is that, you know, I have to be honest with you, Mark.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we can't just wait just for you to just get the books published.
That's the purpose of going through the gateways yourself and performing the work as opposed to merely reading
Thanks
the books.
Thanks for clarifying that. Yes, you're right. You're right about that.
Direct contact.
Direct contact. Okay, so with that... how would you recommend most people can help, you know, Primal Craft has its, and Primal Craft, its initiates, Primal Craft and people who follow the path through the books and go through the rituals and so have you, there has to be a more profound way that people can, you know, work through the rituals and also to help you, help Primal Craft go forward and really bring everything a lot more, let's say, expanded.
There is, but again, it's very much a case of you have to understand that this is work that's undertaken by people at the level of their soul, and what affects the soul will affect the mind and the body.
Okay.
You can't run before you can walk. So the first foundations of getting the knowledge out there to teach people, giving it to people through which they can teach themselves, attain the direct contact, empower themselves, be empowered by the gods, learn the knowledge, bring it through, be given the tasks, that's what we're doing. There is no shortcut. The question that just popped into my head, and I don't have the answer to it specifically, unless I were to go and sit down and contact the cat later and then, would be, okay, so given the time scale to the rebalancing of the world, so it's very short,
right.
Okay, why wait until my lifetime to bring this forward? I would have to come back to you at a later interview with that. Off the top of my head, what I feel is that it's about relevance, and it's again about readiness. It's about choice. It's about having watched man and watched man. And look how much we've accelerated in a, not in a good way, with technology since the 20th century.
Right.
Before the 20th century, what were we? We were steam engines. We weren't really a great threat. We were steam engines and gunpowder, okay? We weren't toxic super chemicals, super oil tankers, you know? I mean, how long have we been drilling for oil? It hasn't been that long. So once you hit that industrial revolution, once we hit the 20th century, once we hit technology, the gods are watching. They're watching what we do with it. We're making a mess of it. Maybe now they've decided, okay, we're now at whatever the divine and infernal equivalent of DEFCON 2 is. We need to do something about this. Reintegrate and reinitiate the Atlantean current. Let's bring it forward and do something about it. But again, when you're dealing with immortal souls and mortal incarnate forms, it has to be done properly. This is the other thing. All of these problems are intrinsic to man's nature. His greed, his ego, his I want this and I want it now. And we are in an age where people, I hit this button, I get it. I pay, it's delivered. And that's not the way spiritual evolution works, but a lot of people have tried to fashion certain occult paths to that, you know? As the Spanish say, your pago. I pay for that, you give it to, you know? It doesn't work like that. So when people do that, with that attitude, and I can see it in certain occult streams, shall we say, there are people, and they're now being encouraged to, you pay for this, you get it. Spiritual evolution doesn't work like that. It's not a guaranteed path, and it's not a question of finance. Therefore, when you're using a genuine path, a path that has not been diluted, a path that has been brought back because it's not diluted, because the path of outside of, you know, a very few cultures and you know, intense secretive tribal paths has been diluted and has been lost. You don't have the passing down of the power from the ancestors anymore. The only way to get what was, if you're looking for that sort of power, something far more powerful, something from source, is from source. It's through direct contact. It's through the inner planes. This is not something that can be circumvented or done quickly. You have to walk before you can run. The foundations have to be laid. It comes down to castles made of sand get toppled very easily. Foundations laid in stone stand the test of time. They're very much the same methodical, sensible, and devoted and powerful application of the work in spiritual transmutation is the same.
I have to challenge you on something, though, because the thing is that you're talking about primal current.
Mm-hmm.
You're talking about primal energy. You're talking about primal origin of where, let's say, our essence, our soul essence,
yeah,
has uprooted from. But going forward, you're also talking about how man has evolved by the flesh, and how he, of course, you know, he's destructive. He's killed his own. He's destroying the earth. He's destroying, you know, what goes in his mouth, and, you know, pretty much it's like inside out.
Yeah.
We are in the age of technology. We are in the age of advancing that way, you know, as far as works of, you know, curing cancer, mm-hmm, to reproduction, to just, you know, nameless things. I mean, this video, for instance, granted, we're not doing this via Skype, we're doing it one-on-one. So what I'd like to ask you is that what you're saying is actually taking away from the other. Most people don't know, but many people, you know, in parts of Africa, but part of Africa, you know, the actual vibration mechanism that goes into the phones is a substance within Earth of Africa, and that itself has killed people. That is, you know, it's the destruction of technology, destroying man, you know, per se, or people, you know, from diamonds to lots of things. What you're saying is counterproductive to the growth of how man is today.
Yeah, how that's the point it's supposed to be. I have to, if you don't, I'll try and answer that question now, if I've got it correct. Technologically advanced has absolutely nothing to do with being spiritually evolved. Just because we are technologically advanced does not mean that we are one, clever, or two, evolved. We are not evolved. We are stagnant. Our spiritual paths are stayed, and they're stagnant. Our tribal cultural initiation rites have been taken away from us,
right,
by, I will have a pop with the Christian church. There's one large organization,
mm-hmm,
that has separated or attempted to separate man from the common man from his ability to tap true raw power. Man who can talk to a god or a goddess does not need, past a certain point, or if at all, an establishment,
yes,
standing in between him.
Indeed.
So we are actually held. We are not in a state of advanced evolution. We are, as I stated at the beginning of the interview, stagnant, stayed, spiritually stunted. Technology, we're using it now. I'm not going to argue means to end, because I don't feel there's an argument into it. We're using a video camera. Okay? Technology. You mean like mobile phone masts that misdirect entire swarms of bees, like insecticides that destroy the bees, so that America has something, and I don't quote me on this, it has enough bees to fulfill one state as opposed to a full country. That in itself is a problem that's going to come and bite the whole of mankind in the backside, okay, as regarding technology at what cost? Technology at the destruction of the planet. Technology with mobile phone masks that are creating cancers. We're curing cancer. Okay, this brings me to another point. That's the perfect vehicle with which to illustrate the difference, or the similarity, I should correct myself. When you've got churches, when you've got paternal solar cults, and they want power, and they want to control how much power the common man, the everyman has, you've got something like Primal Craft that allows you direct contact with the gods and the goddesses, okay, or whatever spirit, genuine spiritual path you follow, then you have access to unlimited power, depending upon your devotion, your ability to wield it, your ability to maintain balance, and what the gods will actually give you, depending on what they believe you're worthy. But the potential is unlimited. Mankind doesn't want common man. The hierarchies don't want common man having that. So when we're talking about technology, I'm not an uber fan of technology, and I don't see that it correlates in any way to man's evolution. In fact, it's probably more headed towards our destruction. I'm not picking on America because you're American. I love American people. But the American medical institution, there is it's a fruit or a vegetable. It's native to South America. Google it. It's something like 10,000 times more powerful than chemotherapy for curing cancer. And it's banned by the American medical institution in America because it costs tuppence halfpenny. I saw one the other day, a friend of mine had one in his house. They get them and they eat them. I shan't name names. I'm not sure if it's banned in Spain under their medical concept. But that, it doesn't just cure or aid in curing cancer 10,000 times more powerfully than forms of chemotherapy, etc. It actually is a preventative measure. A lot of people are going to lose a lot of euros and dollars if that is removed from the banned list. So I don't advocate, I don't support that stance of technology, etc. I feel that what I'm seeing is actually diametrically opposed to technology. We have gone into decline in spiritual evolution. We have gone into overdrive in the destruction of our planet since we've had more technological advances. Being technologically proficient doesn't make you evolved or clever. Okay? It gives you a false sense of your own intelligence. Again, I refer, we've been here less than 100,000 years to our own minds and our own egos. Our scientists may believe that they are extremely advanced with technology. Maybe we'll hit a point where we'll become too dangerous with technology towards other beings or other entities. That's not for me to say. But we've been here a mere 100,000 years. A few hundred years ago, the leading lights, with the most sarcasm I could savagely drip when I say that, told Christopher Columbus that he was a fruitcake who was going to sail off the world because it was flat. One man defied them, and it turns out that he was right and they were wrong.
Yes.
These were all the hierarchies, the geniuses of their day, etc. Yes. So I don't subscribe to technology being good. And, well, what would we do without it? What would I do without it? Communication device that I have with. You get used to relying on things, you know. If we have to go back, I spend sometimes a few weeks on end up at the temple with a few, you know, little hexi blocks and heat up some food. No phones, no people, it's blissful. And no form of communication, no nothing. Okay, I'm an ex-military, it's not difficult for me to go off into the woods, etc. It's not that hard. We're adaptable. Why is technology such a crutch? Because we've allowed it to become one. But it's again a perfect example. Regarding this work, there's no link, no correlation between it and technology. And this tap a button, I buy it now, I want it now, it's crept into the occult.
Yes.
And people are actually fashioning paths along that way. You can have this now. And it's encouraging people, no, I want this now. They don't want to work for it. They don't want to carve and fashion sigils. They don't want to make sacrificial flesh. If that is their view, I would advise them to stay away from the primal craft because they will fail and it will end badly. There is an element of things having to be done properly, not because I say so, because the eyes of the gods, the power and the energies and the beings that grant this, they created this path. They bestow or they take away this sort of energy. So that there is an element of, you know, there's a limit. Man has to realize his ceiling with his ego.
Well, it's not the digital craft, it's the primal craft, you know, it would be the digital craft, so there are some digital crafts out there, and you get what you put into it, a digital residual of something that doesn't really penetrate. But with that, let's go into the commercial aspect a little bit, because I do know that Primal Craft is a publishing company.
It is, yes.
And you've published from, you know, with others before, but now you're doing your own books, and I have to say that your books are really great.
Thank you.
I mean, they're of substance. I do recall you saying something that was so funny to me before. It was said, you have an aversion for skinny books, and
I do.
Yes, and I thought that was really cool, because it brought great, I'd say, it brought me back home when I picked up your first book, and it was thicker, and it didn't have, it wasn't a typical grimoire that was borrowed from, well, it wasn't a grimoire, but, you know, it wasn't a grimoire borrowed from this and borrowed from that, or reskinned.
No.
It was totally different.
Repackaged, reprinted, yes. and heated up for the general public. No,
yeah, on the assembly line and things like that. Not to mention that every book is consecrated. And
each and every individual one, yeah.
And as well as one thing I do, and one thing that I thought that was just really just brilliant, and I really appreciate the work that you do put into everything, is because you do handwrite everything.
Mm-hmm.
And you do, you know, the work that you put into this is a true book,
yeah.
You know, opposed to just typing it out, and no offense to the self-publishers out there, but it's not something that you just put together in a Word document or anything like that.
Oh, were it that simple? I probably wouldn't enjoy the process as much. No, the rituals within the book are all, as I covered before, bar some of the malefic ones. And some of them are performed, the malefic ones have had to have been in the past. They're all performed, the path's been walked, and the currents assimilated successfully within that. Then when it comes time beyond that particular phase of my own work and what's being brought to me, what I'm being challenged with by the Kate to perform, and sometimes she does challenge me to perform things, and there's sometimes I'm given things that I don't want to perform. There have been some sacrifice rites that I just haven't wanted to do, and they've been done as acts of devotion so that the work has been performed. Yes, I get a lot of power out of it. Yes, I get even more knowledge out of it. But it's not a must-have for me at this stage. However, some of this knowledge, she insists I work so that the people on the receiving end of it, that it's been work, they can see that, they can feel that. I do write all of the books by hand. It's probably not pretty in first draft, but
you've shown me the books.
I write all of the books by hand, and then once the books are written by hand, I go to the temple, and in possession, I consecrate the texts in blood. In the past, with my own blood, empowered in possession, recently in sacrifice and my own blood, as was the formula given to me by Hecate. Then the books are typed out so that they can be printed and formatted, and that the process of ensuring that the standard and the quality of not just the materials, which I think everyone knows is very high, from the paper to the bindings, they're all now hand-bound, beginning with the Order of Sacrifice, which is a hugely time-consuming, genuine hand-bound books. It's time-consuming. Some of them are still being bound now. The latter amount of the Altar of Sacrifice, they're still being bound by the binders now, as we speak here in February. But not just the quality there, but the quality of obviously the words are powerful, the formula is powerful, but getting all the typos out. I see some great authors, and they're lazy. It's very difficult to go through everything time and time again. But when people are paying such a lot of money for a book, when it's only going to be published once, it has to be as close to perfect, if not perfect, as close to perfect as we can get it. That's part of the pride of putting this work forward in Primal Craft. As you mentioned, The books are individually consecrated. Now that's done within a vortex with the call and the presence in manifestation of the four demon princes and the four gods. And it's an absolutely exhausting process. After they're numbered, they are individually consecrated. So it's one book in my hands at a time, and it takes, well, several minutes for each book. It's not a couple of second process. The book has to be, it's consecrated in incense, it's consecrated in possession, so that the beings and the entities come through, they come through me, they go into the book, the gateways of the book are opened, the spirits that need to be put into the book are put in by the possessing entity, Hecate, Belial, Lucifer, Sephiroth, sometimes all four, with the altar of sacrifice. It was busy inside of myself working and bringing this forward in this way. And these beings sometimes are drawn through, coaxed through, bound in by Hecate. And the gateways are open and woven and bound in to the book in that way. The book then needs to be opened as part of the process. And this is all done with incense. It's done with energy, okay, with these particular books. And the book itself is consecrated. The wording is specific for each volume. However, with each individual copy of each volume, it can change because, and that's done in possession, that's not by me, it's done by the gods. Different curses, different blessings are woven within each book. There's, for instance, the book may be going to someone who is, in the eyes of the Queen of Hell or Lucifer, not worthy of the book, who is, I don't know, for whatever reason, would try to misuse it, its power, or just mistreat the work, in which case they could well be looking to have a serious mishap. Let's just call it some misfortune for want of a generalization. Okay? And it may then, that's that particular aspect of curse or element, or it could be worse than that, or it might never happen. It depends on where the book is going and who goes it. Then it may well be passed on to someone else who is going to treasure the book and work with the book, and then the book will open its gifts, its gateways and its blessings, and the spirits will come forth. As I mentioned before,
yes,
elements and elementals, yes, and gods coming forth with the book. That's this particular edition. The deluxe editions, I try to sign and sigilize as many, even if the standard isn't a word I would use for the blood pact edition of the Art of Sacrifice because of the level of quality, but for a generalization, the standard editions, I try to personalize them as much as I can. Anyone who asks me to sign the book, I never say no. I sign the book, I sigilize it for them. The deluxe editions, I use a separate ink and I use a nibbed pen to do the numbering, to do the signing, to do the sigilizations, and the ink is then infused with my blood. And that's done that's ritual. It's ritualized, it's empowered in ritual before we get to the actual sigilization, and then the books are consecrated. But that's done in possession, so the power of the blood, as most people will know, if you're spiritual, your blood carries that power. You call Lucifer in full possession, or Belial, or Sephiroth, or Hecate, it doesn't matter, Lachesis, Clothophobos, whoever you're working with, that power rises. That's what then comes out and drips into the ink. That is then held and bound within a sigil, within a structure. As someone once pointed out to me, I've had two people question my method in doing that. Someone said, well, your blood is in the deluxe books, that can be used against you. Have you tried using a sigil of the gods that's formed with blood against the person who issued that? That's actually a very bad formula for a serious astral backlash or a returned malefica. And with this book, I'm having 7 temple initiate copies done. They will have snake heads bound upon them. They will be numbered, signed, sigilized, and consecrated purely in blood. And someone challenged me on that recently and actually asked me if I was insane or a magician who does that doesn't know what he's doing. Au contraire, when you're working under the will of someone like Hecate, and that will flow through the blood in possession, then what comes out, the transmutation of that blood, what is transmuted at the other end and laid within the book, is something along the lines of the blood of the possessing entity. And blood, as most people know, in sigil, or poured into a groove, or drawn in sigil, opens a gateway through the inner planes, which is also part of this. It's part of the empowering when done in possession, when your blood and your code of possession has ignited as the possessing entity what spills forth in blood upon the pages of the only seven books that I do that with, or within the ink of the deluxe books, is the will of that particular being. And that's one of the underlying reasons and kind of the madness behind the method, if you want to call it that, of using blood in the consecration of the books. It's extremely powerful. It's the source of life and manifestation with the will of a possessing god or daemon or demon or being within it. It's far, increasingly more powerful, far more powerful.
Well, I have to say that that's a lot, and I have seen the cost of the books.
Yes.
Given that you put so much into it, I think that you are not charging enough.
Really?
I have to say that, I really do, because you know, that's, I have to say that, because you know, you're talking about priceless, you're giving away a part of yourself, you're giving away the knowledge, you're giving away artwork, you're giving away time, you're giving away blood, you're giving away, you know, just you,
yeah.
And that is, in a way, a very selfless way, but as a devotee, I understand that.
There has to be a balance.
Yes.
There was for, at one stage, from certain parties, there was, by way of, not Primal Craft, by way of justification for releasing, from going from purely talismanic works to releasing ebooks and paperbacks, there was a big hue and cry of people should be able to access the knowledge, you know, however much money they have in their pockets, etc., etc. I don't disagree with that, but if you can't, you know, if you can't locate a copy of Queen of Hell, from the same source was a similar speech a couple of years previous to that, that was, you know, saving for a book and actually making a financial sacrifice is a sacrifice and a magical act within itself. I don't disagree with that either. You can't have it both ways. The books are not cheap. The Altar of Sacrifice is the most expensive book because it's hand-bound. I suppose if you were to count up, I mean, I won't get into figures because finance doesn't motivate me. I need to be able to cover the, you know, the formation and the publication of the books. The Altar of Sacrifice was far more than twice any of the most expensive books that I've had published to date to have made. Now, if you were to sell all 999 of them at once, and that doesn't happen with Primal Craft, I actually turn a lot of people down for book sales. Excuse me, if I feel the books aren't going to the right place. If it's just some mercenary eBay seller that wants to buy for 50 books and sell them at €300 a book while it's in print for €67, and I haven't counted that before, then I will refuse the money, and I have done, and it upsets people because they can't have their way with me, they can't fathom me, they tend to be uncomplimentary, and, well, that's just normal, predictable things. So the books don't all sell at once, and they don't anyways, so it takes time for the right people to find the books. I would rather that the case than, you know, 999 books sell to the wrong people on one day. They are, I feel, as expensive as they need to be, and realistically, with, I hate talking about money, but with the money coming in over, you know, a lengthy period of time, as cheap as I can make them in order to publish the next book. If I've got enough money to publish the next book and getting by, that's all I'm interested in. If I was motivated by finance or then I would put the price of the books up, you know, and not worry about people being able to afford them. Or I would go back to freelance soldiering in the private security sector or something like that. It doesn't motivate me anymore. It is, as you said, a complete act of devotion. I have had people, as I mentioned before, approach me and say, oh, I can't get Queen of Hell, I can't get the Red King. They're like £400 on eBay. And these people, they'll still have the emails, I write back. And I say, okay, while I don't like it, I don't necessarily agree with it. I'm not against the fact that maybe you should go and get yourself a PDF. That to me negates the fact that, you know, it negates the comment of any kind of justification of selling all different range of books, which it's great. I've got nothing against paperbacks. It's not for me. I started out doing talismanic books and individually consecrating every single one. Even when I was with Exaxa, the lady who runs it, we sat together and I did all the books. At the time, she did the numbering. And, you know, I will finish doing that. However many books I do or do not publish, each and every individual single copy will be opened and empowered and consecrated in possession as a gateway to its patron, to its source, to its relevant vortex. Or I won't do them anymore. I own paperback books. I don't really buy books these days. I'm so immersed in what I'm doing. But, you know, I've got nothing against a paperback book. But for me and some other people who started out doing solely talismanic works and things like that, then that paperback, I will never go down that route. I will not look for an excuse that is tantamount to making more money through which to put out forth a paperback book or an e-book. It's not what I'm about. The books are gateways, they're talismans, they're consecrated gateways. That's why there's only 999 of them. That's the instruction in the mind that was given by Hecate. That's also why I don't get overly upset when I get people write to me and they say, okay, I read your first two books, I have a confession to make. I read them in PDF format. I say, okay, thank you, I appreciate your honesty. I can normally feel that someone's not being straight with me through an email anyways. I say, I appreciate your honesty, and you know, I'm happy to help that person, or, you know, let them have a copy of The Scorpion God, etc., etc. But the purpose of Primal Craft is to make sure that these gateways, that they're offerings as well. I mean, this book, it's not just a gateway, it's not just a consecrated
tome. It's a beautiful book. I've even talked to a librarian in the UK who is not, I'm not sure what
that is. Not a cultist, no?
No, not at all. And she just said this is an absolutely beautifully made book. She didn't understand what was in it.
No.
But she, you know, the power that she felt and just the energy, she just kept on, she wanted to hold it and, you know, it was mine. So she didn't hold it for long. But you've gotten reviews from people who aren't a cultist that say this is just absolutely beautiful book.
As well, the book and what I put forward, it's an offering to its patron. That's my offering. That's my devotion in return for being given this knowledge, because it is an honour to have been chosen for this manner. It is an honour to bring forth this work. Sometimes it can be very stressful, it can be distressing. It's not an easy path to walk. The understanding just the knowledge and the prophecies that I brought through, let alone the transmutational work and the assimilating the currents and the energy, it's sometimes with mixed blessings, because sometimes it can be very distressful taking all that in and seeing what's going to happen. And also, you know, if I didn't enjoy the power, if I didn't bask in it and soak it up, and I didn't enjoy the knowledge, I wouldn't be telling the truth right now, okay? So in return for that, making the books as beautiful and as best quality as I can, that's my offering, and giving this manifestation that is in part, you know, consecrated and blessed as a gateway and a part of the body and the flesh of the individual god or patron that it is consecrated to, that it is dedicated to. That's my offering, and that's one of the reasons why that the books have to be high quality, that they have to remain that way. I do want to interject. You kind of set me up for a fall with this. I don't like skinny books. No, Queen of Hell. I love Queen of Hell. It was the first full book that I wrote in my offering to Hecate, and it's the smallest book. The Altar of Sacrifice is actually the largest. The Scorpion God is the largest volume of pages because of its amount of sigils and seals within it. In order to make the Scorpion God complete, I had to put all of the relevant seals in, and it's like over 300. So it's like just over 404 pages. And at 84,000 words. The Altar of Sacrifice is actually bigger. It's 93,000 words, but there are less.
Oh, wow.
There's like about 158 seals in it. So it's 400 pages long, 396 pages long. Okay. The next book, The Witch Blood Grail, it is going to be slightly smaller. It's going to be closer to the Red King size.
Okay.
Somewhere between Queen of Hell and the Red King. The knowledge in it is very, very intense. And there are more individual segments, more individual chapters in this next book. But the actual overall content volume is slightly smaller. But the reason for that is that I need to draw a line past the Witchblood Grail in order to complete the third book. Because from the look of the notes and the volume of work that is going to go into that, and the work I'm still working on some of the rituals, the last of the rituals for the third book, but that's going to be huge. That's going to be the biggest book to date. Therefore, I needed the Altar of Sacrifices, the introduction of the temple, all of the formulas, the apocalyptic keys, and forming, and we can cover it a bit later, so the formation of the temple dragon, the body of the temple. The Witchblood Grail is the completion of that work. It is the path and the formula of all the various initiations. It contains, as a matter of heritage of lost work, the rites and rituals of human sacrifice. Not advised that they are, well, it's up to the individual, but it's not advised or advocated that they're performed. They're brought back because they are part of lost heritage. So there is a small section that's covered, and the rituals are complete, has brought back in direct contact of human sacrifice within the Witchblood Grail. But also within that is the completion of the formula that opens the gates to Belial's throne. It opens the crystal gates. It is the completion of the formula of the Mother Temple of Four Pillars of Fire that exists in the Spanish Mountains that I've given so that other people can open these vortices. There is the completion of the temple, the art of the Temple Malefica, and all of the rites that came therein. The Witchblood Grail is the catalyst within which the power and formula of the Altar of Sacrifice is ignited. It's the keys through which you can open the third book. You can take these books individually, okay, but there is a certain formula within the three books as a trilogy that requires the Witchblood Grail because it holds certain keys. Okay, so while they are standalone books, they are also part of a greater trilogy. The third book will be the largest to date, and it's going to contain all of the work and the sum of the work to date. Some of it will be very dark. Okay, all of the sum of the work to date has come through the temple vortex. So. And that will be the completion of this particular trilogy of the volumes of the Way of Sacrifice.
I'm going to ask you one final question because I've noticed something on your site. On the primalcraft.com, you are a publishing company.
Yes.
You have some great books out there. You introduce parts of the Primal Craft current through the description of the books because
yes.
It gives people that added edition of what Primal Craft is about.
Yeah.
Why is it that you don't advertise for initiates? Why is it that you don't even advertise for authors?
Okay. Within the Primal Current and the role that I was given to bring forth this particular knowledge, the work that I've done, taking aside the transmutational work, the phoenix work, Hecate, and I won't get into the specifics of which rites they are, but Hecate has put me through an awful lot of work and transmutational work, most of which is released, some of which will never be released, that has fashioned me as the vessel through which she wants this knowledge brought through, this current brought through, and reignited and reintroduced in that way. As regarding publication, Primal Craft and the Primal Craft Occult Publishing is the sole publishing house for that, because I've been doing this a long time, and unless she directs me personally otherwise, I won't publish other work. I don't have time. At one book per year, and we've done four books in 4 years, that's me flat out. I actually get asked by, maybe not Primal Craft people that are working within Primal Craft and people that have been initiated at the Mother Temple tend to get given separate roles. Hecate has her gatekeeper, her curator, caretaker of the temple, her scribe. What she's looking for now are princes of fire, people who can open the four pillars of fire and open them correctly, not people that come looking for kudos or branding or looking to hang on, dare I say it, it sounds awfully egotistical, not myself, but the coattails of Primal Craft, people that are looking to give genuine, devoted work, people that are fire, they are given a practice and a formula, and that involves, say, sacrifice, will actually commit the act and art of devotion of giving that bloody sacrifice or forming a particular physical structure or restoring the physical structure that they're guided to and creating a temple in that way, as opposed to allowing their higher selves to tell them, well, you're really experienced, so you can draw a sigil on paper and, you know, I can pass on it. I can say I've done the sacrifice, but in actual fact, it reads through the inner planes, it comes through in possession, contact from the gods, in one particular instance, told me that it was everything to the contrary. Basically, a task was given and it wasn't performed properly, and the task was given by the cat and Lucifer. So there has been one trip hurdle in that way, and it does happen, and that's called human nature, the human condition and the human ego. Okay, so when people come forward in this way, they tend to be given that. What she's looking for is the best example at this moment in time is the lady who's doing the Garden of the Fountain of the Gods. If that woman says she will do something, she will do it, and she will do it. Now she's being given instruction direct from the Kate, and the physical things that need to be done, the constructs, the little temples, all the things that Tecate and Lucifer and Belial and Sephiroth want placed in this. It's a large expanse of land. What is required and what is needed is being provided for this person, not by me, but it's a relation between herself and the four pillars of fire, the four gods. That was the task that she was given. That's the task that she's fulfilling now. Okay, so the people that come in this way, they tend to get given other tasks. The gentleman who's building the Temple of Belial, it's not a pillar of fire per se. It is a temple for Belial. Belial wants this man to build, and he's on that now. He's working on that now. He'll do it. He's had a few setbacks in locations and things like that. That's part of the process, following the intuition to the right place. So the people that come from different paths or parallel paths, I do get manuscripts sent to me. I'm sure there are publishers out there, naming no names, that are quite happy that I'm not publishing these other people's works. I don't have time, nor inclination. Primal Craft Occult Publishing is solely a vehicle for the transmission of the primal current of Hecate and of the Trident. So I won't be publishing other people's work. It's flattering to be sent these other manuscripts, but it's not what I'm about, and I'm not about to begin publishing three or four manuscripts of other people's work, as good as the ones that have been sent are, purely to boost up financial gain, because that takes away from the ethos of what I'm trying to achieve and what Hecate wants me to achieve within the Primal Craft itself. So I don't advertise for initiates, to answer the other part of the question, because I feel that if people are drawn to the current, when I was in the military, not to take things on to too much of a mundane conversation, I worked in certain areas, in certain parts of the army that don't advertise, but yet anyone who has, you know, been in the British Army always has there's an inner desire to serve in these places.
Yes.
To be part of these very small places, these units, and they don't advertise, and yet people come to them. I feel that if it's correct, it's correct. I don't advertise for initiates. I don't want to be seen to be advertising for initiates, because I don't really want them. I don't want that per se. Initiates will come. I want quality souls and devoted souls to merge with the gods, to take this current, to be empowered by this current, to succeed in the initiations that I open for them, and to go forth with the tasks that they're given by the gods at that temple. I'm party to this, I can see what's happening, I can feel what's happening, I can hear the gnosis. However, I am but the gatekeeper. these devoted souls, one of those is with 10,000 people that are going to come seeking purely power, only for themselves, not in devotion. That's not what we're after. I just don't believe in the advertising for initiates. It doesn't seem to serve any purpose. I think people are aware that I initiate. If people are working through the books, the gods and spirits will direct the right people to me. I do still get people who've worked some of the work coming. I can tell who's coming purely for the kudos, who's looking for a fast track to be, for want of a better expression, a name in the occult world, to hold a position because they think it will afford them that. That's very far from the case. The work's in depth, it's long, it's challenging. So really only the devoted souls the only people that should be coming for this are the devoted souls. They're the only ones that will succeed in this, you know. People that are genuinely devoted to spiritual transmutation and to the gods themselves. I hasten to add that not everyone who comes will be expected to become involved in this greater picture and what's happening in the world, nor will they be expected to be confined solely within their self-imposed bubble. Awareness is everything.
Indeed.
The whole point of this work is to bring awareness.
Indeed. Well, that's a suicide from quite a bit of people, at least online, that's for sure. Not to mention the people and the places that want to build in numbers, per se, and basically just farm it out such as some large institution rather than a spiritual movement, a spiritual point of awareness internally, and then really giving back to everyone else. So with that, it goes along with everything else that you do, and that is of quality.
Yeah, well, the numbers, not everyone, but a vast majority, the numbers are usually only related to personal egotistical pride and kudos.
Of course.
And or financial gain.
Mm.
Numbers don't mean anything. Like I said, I always go back to one devoted soul is worth far more than 10,000 non-devoted souls. You know, Justin Bieber has a huge following. The Pope of Rome has a huge following, neither of which I personally find particularly useful on this planet.
Yeah,
so that's just my analogy of looking at large followings. It's not necessarily the case with each individual in the occult fraternity. There are people who have large followings that are really good and really dedicated. They're just rare.
Indeed. Well, you know, I've asked a lot of you, we'll probably go ahead and have a little bit of this and a little bit of that about Primal Craft, you know, throughout all of the interviews. But is there anything that you would like to add that maybe I didn't bring up that you would like everyone to know about Primal Craft, the actual Primal Craft overall across the board in every case?
I think I'd like people just to get an understanding of where Primal Craft is going. I mean, we've covered the fact that, you know, with the volumes of sacrifice and the opening of these temple gateways and the Mother Temple, etc., that you can't do that with, you know, on a bloodless path. We've also covered the fact that within Primal Craft itself, there is a bloodless path. People working the Trident Trilogy may never open or perform, even if they do read out of interest, the works from within the volumes of sacrifice. I think what I would like people to understand is the formation of these temple vortices. The Mother Temple has been formed, but for people that wish to open their own forest altars, when I say temple, there are many different forms of temple. The formula within the altar of sacrifice, within that book, gives people just that. The formula, the ability, the power, the knowledge with which to open these gateways and empower themselves and connect not only with the primal gods, the gods of the Trident, but ancient spirits of the place, the gods of the forest, and also the ancestors of the Witch Flame, the Atlantean priesthood, and their own spiritual ancestors. So they're tapping their own witch bloodline and then getting power direct to the soul, knowledge direct to the conscious mind through the gates of the soul that they wouldn't get through templated or otherwise diluted grimoires or books that have been rewritten throughout history, for want of a better expression, etc. Then to understand that the capability to attain this is within the altar of sacrifice, the formula within this. To open the way of sacrifice itself, to connect with the ancestors, to work with your ancestors, with the ancestors of Witchflame itself, with the Atlantean priests. There are souls of Atlantean priests and souls of people that worked this knowledge 30,000 years ago, 20,000 years ago, that can be connected with. I don't mean the renegades that walk the deserts with the fire spirits hopping from body to body, pushing other souls out. They've taken their own path, and that's their own weight upon their soul to bear or not at some point or other, depending on how long they wish to remain around the mundane plane. They've been here a long time already. I'm talking about those that still operate within the current of Akate, that haven't just taken the power and run, that remain devoted. They can be connected with. They have immense. Imagine connecting with a being that's been working on a spiritual level, not one of the gods, which is vast anyways, but another soul who's been working for 20, 30, 40,000 years since the real ignition of the first civilized cultures. An advanced Atlantean priest to call through a being like that. Imagine being able to open a gateway within your soul and invert through a gateway within your own soul and descend to a forest of aeons past, enter the body of an animal within that soul, conscious mind, entering within a conscious mind, enter within a body of flesh with a conscious mind, something like that. These are all things that are attainable. I'd like people to be able to, just at least from what I'm saying now, get a glimpse of, you know, the full spectrum of possibilities through these rituals. And the formation of temple altars, forest altars, and Atlantean temples, the formation of the full temple, of the mother, temple of four pillars of fire, and the subsidiary temples, whether they connect through the dragon lines to the mother temple, and then connect all the way back to the Atlantean realms, or whether they connect direct, that's of little consequence to me. That's up to the individual's choice. But in performing this formula, in forming these temples, they're actually forming and remembering, okay, draconian entities, the body of the dragon. They form a temple entity, a power, the temple dragon. That being in itself holds or is connected to an ancient consciousness that is connected to the great dragon of the earth, the great beast itself. Now we're into the deeper realms of witchcraft. We're touching upon apocalyptic gnosis. We're touching upon very ancient gnosis. That's the potential within this work. I would like people to understand that it's not purely the altar of sacrifice, the volumes of sacrifice, this particular path within the primal craft is not purely about bloody sacrifice itself. That is a vehicle through which to access this power and through which to give offering and devotion. And I believe we covered that, you know, even at an empathic level, where you have to feel what the sacrifice is feeling. And so hopefully people can make an informed decision from looking at that and be able to see where primal craft, if they feel that it interests them, if they feel the call of Akate or any of the gods within primal craft, and they feel that this is for them, at least they have an overlying brief, you know, a glancing brief of the knowledge, an opportunity to understand the possibilities that lie within it, should it appeal to them, and where it can take them from there. After that, then their work and their introduction will be through the books or through myself, which may or may not lead to them opening their own temple, via initiation or self-initiation, either at the mother temple or through the books, or through direct teaching from myself. Inevitably, the goal is direct contact with the gods. After that, that's between themselves and the gods and the path that they take and the learning and the task that they're given. That's out of my hands.
Well, thank you for that, because that's actually a lot to take in. As usual, all the interviews that you give are very intense and very thorough, very elaborately put together and so eloquently, you know, given back to everyone out there. As usual, I always ask you, who would you like to dedicate the video to this time that we've had? Because I do know that dedication is so much and so very important to you.
It's very important to me, yes. Well, my devotion always goes first and foremost to Hecate. I do spread my devotion, per se, through Sephiroth, Belial, Lucifer, and Hecate, and the many others, the Moiras, and the other the gods who I'm lucky enough to have contact with and to work with, regarding the dedication of this particular interview, I would like to dedicate it to Sephiranz, Atlantean Devil Queen, Queen of the Primal Gods, who ruled over the Earth and its inner planes before the race of man was created, and she who ruled over the Primal Gods and oversaw the first evolution of man, until the fall of the Atlantean race. Sephiranz, in her primal form, that the gateways have now opened, now risen and conjoined with her more recent form in the last few millennia of the Daughter of War, Conquest and Fire. Sephiranz, who will, for what could be called the greater good, bring forth as the apocalyptic goddess, the Daughter of War, Conquest and Flame, the necessary cataclysmic and traumatic changes to this planet to rebalance the world soul, if we as a race do not manage to rebalance it before it is weighed by the hand of Lucifer in 344 years' time. Sephiranz, who has protected my soul, guided my soul, hand in hand with Belial in the Atlantean depths, and who has, as the daughter of Akati and Lucifer, and the female counterpart and sister of Belial, brought so much rich knowledge and allowed me to experience things that even as a practitioner and devotee of Witch Flame, I didn't think was possible. I dedicate this interview to you, Sephiranz, Daughter of War, Conquest and Flame, Atlantean Queen. Thank you.
Thank you.